Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
It's a news-filled day, so I have not one or two, but three stories that I shall try and declutter for you. In fact, declutter two and third, maybe a little bit more of a comment from me. So the first one is the big expose or story again by N. Ram in the Hindu. Now, if you've been watching me and if you've been reading me, you might not be wrong to conclude that I've been a skeptic on, or relative skeptic on, Rafale being a mega defense scandal. I have said many times that there is a scandal. It's called stupidity, government not coming clean, government doing things in too much of a hurry, but not really a scandal of big proportions. Also, Anil Ambani getting these offsets up ahead like this sounds scandalous, but not like a mega defense scandal. But let me tell you, this latest expose from N. Ram makes me rethink as well. Because what does it say? I am trying to, as I said, declutter it for you. It's a very long story. You can read it. Go to the Hindu's website and read it. But in a sense, what does it say? First of all, what are offsets? In the defense procurement procedure that UPA government under AK Antony finalized, something was going on from earlier on, but it was finalized. About 50% of the value of defense purchases that India makes, 50%, the equivalent of 50% of that value, has to be produced in India by Indian manufacturers, not necessarily for that system. So, for example, if India buys, say, Scorpion submarines from France, then that company that sells Scorpion submarines will have to spend half the value of that purchase in buying goods manufactured in India under its orders. So offsets are basically a compensation to India, to the buyer, for placing a large order to say that, look, all right, you are selling to us something that we can't make, make it and give it to us, but because we are giving you so much money, you create facilities or issue orders, so facilities are created to produce goods worth so much to be bought by you, so India gets jobs created and taxes. That is essentially what offsets are. So half of this deal, which is almost 30,000 crores, half is almost 30,000 crores, was the amount of offsets that Dassault had to create in India. What this report by N. Ram tells you is that, one, the offsets deal, and I am not necessarily going in the sequence in which the story lists them. I am going by the sequence in which I see the importance of his assertions. So the first is that offsets were structured in such a way that first 3 years, almost nothing will have to be produced. Fourth year onwards, a little bit will have to be produced. But the real weight of the offset production would come in the seventh year. Now, okay, Dassault and others would argue that, look, we can't just order something for it to start being produced right away. It takes time to set up a factory, to find a vendor, and then for technology to be transferred and for something to be produced. But that having said, in that case, should the value of the offsets 7 years later be the same as it is today? Because money loses value as time passes. I am making it, some people have responded to Cut the Clutter saying, it looks like it's not for specialists, it's for lay people, and since I know so much, I don't need to watch it. That's a correct view. None of us is a specialist on everything. Most of us are not specialists or anything. I'm a journalist, so I try to simplify it for you as much as possible. So if you say you owe me 100 rupees today, but I will give it to you in 7 years. So what happens? Then you discount that money at some value. If it's Indian rupee in India, you will discount it at about 8 to 10%. So 10 rupees after 7 years will become what? It will become less than 5 rupees or thereabouts. My math may not be very good at this. But once you take net present value of a, if you take 100 rupees now and take 100 rupees 7 years from now, then the net present value of that 100 rupees is much less right now. Or look at it in an even more simple way. If you deposit 10 rupees, even 50 rupees, even in a post office fixed deposit, in 10 years, I know interest rates are a bit low right now, in 10 years approximately, that will become a 100 rupees. So if you were to create offsets worth that money now, it will be worth a 100 rupees. If you create it after 7 years, it will be worth 50 rupees. So this is called front loading of a contract or back loading of a contract. So in this case, the offset commitment has been back loaded, to which the bureaucracy in the MOD raised objections. The Defense Acquisition Committee put it forward to the Cabinet Committee on Security, which took a call to overrule this. Remember one more thing, as this article tells you, that the money India is paying to Dassault to manufacture the aircraft is pretty much being paid in advance. In fact, about one-fourth or one-third has already been, one-third has already been paid. So it means that payments are front-loaded, payouts are front-loaded. Offset obligations are backloaded. So if most of your offsets are to be delivered 7 years later, why don't you calculate this on the basis of net present value, even if its value is in euros, where NPV value will require less of a differential than, say, in Indian rupees. India should get the benefit of that. So that, to me, is a key takeaway from today's story. Now, the government may say there was urgency, we had no choice. They can even say offsets are a stupid idea. A stupid idea? Don't do offsets. It's not as if every Indian defense deal has offsets. Which one doesn't? I will tell you. Just recently, it was in the air for some time, but India signed, after very quick negotiations, a deal to buy S-400 missiles. What is the cost of the deal? $10 billion, which is almost 65-70,000 crore rupees. What is the value of offsets in that deal? You can make a guess. Obviously, if I'm saying so, it might be low. I don't know how many guessed it right, but the value of offsets in that deal is zero, double zero. Because many of these deals with many countries, particularly with Soviet Union, are not done with offsets. So government could have said, look, offsets are not needed. We will negotiate the price in such a way that India draws the benefit, but they didn't do it. But, and finally, all these excuses vanish because one important thing happened. This thing came with a killer issue, and that is, before offsets were announced, before offsets were made open to the market, you had somebody begging the first set of offsets. That is Anil Ambani for his company, which had been incorporated just weeks before this deal was finalized. So that is what Ram also says in conclusion to his story, that what we know is that a company, that these offsets were backloaded, but a company incorporated just weeks before this deal was finalized got its own offsets sort of front-loaded. So that is the essential feature of today's story. And that makes even those who might have been skeptical on this being a big scandal rethink. And once again, important thing that Ram has done today, he said very clearly that I don't question the quality of the Rafale, the fighter, nor do I compare it with Eurofighter, its rival, and say that Eurofighter is better. Nor do I question the fact that Indian Air Force needs to modernize its fleet. So those are very important qualifications. There are a couple of other things, that arbitration clause has been waived for offset contracts, that that government of India has waived its full rights to look at the books of these companies delivering on offsets. But that, those to me are less important than this backloading, front-loading issue, and the fact that just one company has got front-loaded offsets, whatever these are. These are not offsets to make any part of Rafale. These are to make some parts of the Falcon executive jet. So that is the story today, which I hope I've been able to declutter for you, but please do read that story. The second issue today, again related a little bit to defense. Today, there was a big meeting of the important meeting of the army commanders, where a response to Pakistan in case of future terror attacks or provocations was discussed. That response should be swift and should be so punitive that Pakistan then is deterred from doing such a thing again in the future. Now, there are some problems there. The problem is that for the past many decades, including in the last two decades, and it's a theme that I have visited several times and revisited since Palakkad, particularly in last two decades, as the threat of terror has grown, as a nuclear umbrella has been sort of erected over the subcontinent, and a nuclear balance of power has come in, India has not rethought its fundamental conventional doctrine. And what is that conventional doctrine, and why should it differ from the past? In the past, Indian doctrine was generally built around, because the presumption was Pakistanis will get weapons of better technology from Western sources, particularly America, they were allies. Two, that India will have to rely on Russian sources, and Russian equipment is good, but not quite as modern or quite as cutting edge on electronics, etc., as say the American equipment. So one, India should counter Pakistan's Western acquisitions with larger numbers. And India is a much larger economy, much larger country. India can overwhelm Pakistan in the course of time with numbers. And number two, India were designed to fight a longish war of attrition with the Pakistanis that Pakistan will not be able to afford beyond, say, day 5, day 7, day 10, day 14, maybe 3 weeks. Now remember, that even 60 years ago, 55 years ago, when we fought our first major war, Kashmir was a protected war in 47-48, but 65, that war lasted 22 days. In fact, one of the better books on that war, D.R. Mankekar's book on the war, was titled 22 Fateful Days. The next war that India and Pakistan fought, 1971, was fought only for 13 days. So today to think of fighting a war for 10 days, 15 days, etc., is very impractical. So India has to now start reviewing whether it needs to continue building for a medium term or a 10-day or even 15-day or even a 10-day war of attrition. Second, given the size of India's economy now, given that India's economic growth has left Pakistan way behind, and given that India has built its own technological and engineering base, India should not be in a situation where it wants to prevail over Pakistan over a 10-15-day war of attrition, because in a war of attrition like that, India, what India loses, India stands more to lose, because India has more to lose, Pakistan has less to lose. I'll give you an example. See what's happened post Balakot. While the Pakistanis are jumping up and down, saying they shot down one aircraft, two aircraft, 10 aircraft, whatever, just because they've got a pilot to parade, okay, they've got a point, they captured a pilot. But look at what's happened to the markets and the economies in the two countries. Since that day, and everything is not so simplistic, but since that day, more the month of March, which followed immediately Balakot strikes, which were 26th and 27th of the short month of February. Month of March saw the highest inflows of foreign institutional investments into India. So much so that rupee has actually strengthened over the month, even though oil prices have gone up. India's stock markets have boomed. There is some degree of optimism in the air. Nobody is concerned about what might happen. Check what's happened in Pakistan. In Pakistan, the rupee has weakened. There has been more flight of capital. And you've seen many other negative effects. So for India to fight a 10-15-day war, this is not even a war. This is a minor skirmish. It showed you that in terms of the economy, India has a lot more to gain from peace, a lot more to lose from a war which is fought by two countries, and I will qualify what I mean. A country of India's size, an economy which is this much bigger than Pakistan's, a defense budget which is 6 to 7 times greater than Pakistan's, you can invest a little more there and sensibly and change your doctrine to build decisive superiority in certain areas. That can be in long-range artillery, that can be in high-tech fighter aircraft like Rafale, it can be in some aspects of maritime warfare or defense, although I think those Navy comes a bit later in these equations, and build such superiority across along the LOC for punitive raids that Pakistan is denied the option of engaging India in a war of attrition. So instead of preparing for a war of attrition, India has to start thinking of a doctrine and strategy to deny Pakistan a war of attrition and be prepared for an action of deterrence and punishment. That is the only thing that will work. Otherwise, a 10-day or 15-day war, frankly, will be India's gift to Pakistan. Of course, Indian armed forces will prevail as they have done in the past, but it's not something that India now needs to plan for. India is now too big and too powerful for that. So that's my second story. And third is a comment. The comment is just the way, and it's connected with the other two. It's also in a way about defense and military. Prime Minister's use of Balakot strikes and Pulwama terror attack in the election campaign. Other people have used it before from his party. Yogi Adityanath said Modi ki serna, he was censured by the election commission. Other people have said other things. But really, armed forces are not any parties. And when armed forces put on their uniform and go and risk their lives and carry out an action against an enemy, they are following the Republic's orders. They are not following any political party's orders. So for any political party to seek votes in the name of their sacrifice, I say with great humility, is immoral, is wrong, and will have terrible consequences, or can have terrible consequences going ahead, because if one does it, others will do it. And imagine a situation where people in power start thinking that, look, what can I do to improve my electoral prospects? Let me use my armed forces in a way that I can then shift the debate from something else where I might be on the defensive and use my armed forces and their strength to win an election, to win an argument, to divert attention, to do anything. That is a very dangerous thing and very wrong thing. So that is our comment. Also read our 50-word edit on that on the print. I do hope that henceforth there will be restraint on this and that the election commission will do something stronger than just writing a letter and saying you're advised to be more careful.